On Saturday, very un-Mountaineer-like.
And what was also very un-Mountaineer-like, their effort the last time these two teams met. Really, it's been all the way through conference play, a trend that Bob Huggins doesn't like. This Press Virginia team has not had nearly the turnovers or points off turnovers advantage in conference that they had in the pre-conference season.
Playing hard is a skill, and that's something he would like to see them get back to tonight.
It also doesn't sound, talking to Bob Huggins earlier today at the shoot-around, like he much appreciates having to coach effort. Seems like he wants to be able to take effort at the very least for granted.
It's a great point. Great point. You can coach basketball. You can coach effort. It's hard to coach both at the same time.
Cam McGusty loses it, so there is a turnover forced by West Virginia. Throwing one up wildly towards the rim, though. Javon Carter, not sure if that was a shot or a pass. No one was home. In the other direction, Jordan Woodard wastes no time. And back the other way comes Issa Amat.
Remember, no Daxter Miles tonight. Right ankle sprain. They left him back in Morgantown. So Tariq Phillip, right?
Gets Tariq the start. Phillip gets the start. Only I asked about Daxter Miles coming back maybe for the Monday night game against Kansas, and the folks at West Virginia basically said, well, he's on crutches right now, so we'll see. Not sure how optimistic they are that they will even have him for Big Monday against KU. McGusty is able to score the game's first points. And boy, how good has the freshman been against Big 12 competition?
Without a doubt, Bob. 16 points a game for Cam McGusty. And despite some heartbreaking plays at the end of games, including those missed free throws at Texas, he is a rising star.
Elijah Macon goes right at Kadeem Latin and scores.
Oh, I like that because Latin in the past has been a thorn in West Virginia's side at the rim, so Macon went right at him.
From the wing, it's Doolittle. The two freshmen that have both been terrific for OU scoring the first two buckets for the Sooners, and they've got the four-point lead.
Bob, this is such a young team. 70% of their scoring comes from those freshmen and sophomores. The future's bright, but Ron Kruger's thinking about getting another win somewhere.
Macon lost it. Rashard Odom finds Woodard. Doolittle couldn't handle the pass. But Kadeem Latin somehow able to get it free. McGusty around Adrian. Nice shot fake. And he gets it to go. Plus the foul. How about that from Cam McGusty?
Oh, terrific, Bob. He came to a two-foot stop, hesitated with a terrific shot fake, and watch him draw the contact. Two-foot stop was just really, really solid fundamentals. And then you just have to concentrate, keep your eyes on the basket, and hope that you get lucky and the ball drops through.
10 consecutive games in double figures. The longest streak for an OU freshman since Jeff Webster back in the 90-91 season when he went 22 straight games in double figures. But from Augusti, it's all against conference competition. None of the weak sisters that you play in the exhibition season, basically leading up to conference play against Big 12 teams. He's in double figures every night. That's off the mark from Phillip.
Yeah, remember, McGusty was hurt in the non-conference, so we really never saw him at his best. Very little pressure right now from the Mountaineers. Remember, you want to force Rashard Odoms to his right, just like Ahmad did.
McGusty's off the mark. And a nice wall off underneath by Brandon Watkins.
Well, Tariq Phillip has only started 6 games in his career. This is the 7th one tonight. He's been arguably one of the best 6 men in the conference.
Ahmad fumbled it. Somehow saved it to Carter. Carter with a nice find to Watkins, who couldn't hit. McGusty's got the rebound.
That mismatch right now. I remember back in Morgantown, Woodard exploited this just like that.
Right around,
yep.
Adrian.
Sure did. Remember, late game, they switched onto Woodard with Adrian a couple times, and that was the switch that really caused West Virginia problems in game one.
Bob Huggins already with a couple of subs at the table, frustrated with this start from his team after losing at home to Oklahoma State on Saturday. Offensive rebound, Ahmad kept it alive, and it will stay with West Virginia when we come back. But what a start by the Sooners. And as always,
down to five. Woodard got it! And one!
Unbelievable shot.
We're going to overtime in Morgantown. Who expected this? Carter! And one! Woodard running by Adrian.
Oh my goodness!
Woodard for the win. The Oklahoma Sooners have pulled a shocker in Morgantown, beating the seventh-ranked Mountaineers.
It was a stunner back on January 18th. Not only did Jordan Woodard have 20, it felt like he had 40, but he controlled the basketball game, most notably here, Fran. When you think about what West Virginia normally forces turnover-wise and points off turnovers and what they forced in that game. Jordan Woodard controlled it with his own scoring, but also he controlled the safety of the basketball for OU.
He really did. And remember, they were down 15 with a little under 9 to go. He had been on the bench catching his breath. When he came back in, the game turned. And then, of course, they put on West Virginia, one of those five losses to unranked teams, and an overtime loss at home.
Issa Ahmad quickly fouled off the inbound, so he will go to the line. But that's probably Jordan Woodard's best game of the season. He has had games where he has scored more than 20. But if you watched that game, he controlled it throughout. He was the most dominant player on the floor. And that was the highest-ranked road opponent win for OU since 1993. So when you consider who they were playing, the fact that it was on the road, and West Virginia's style of play, how they control things normally with their press, he was just terrific all night.
Absolutely. We went in to do that game, and there was no way anybody thought that Oklahoma would come away with a win, but it's been emblematic of how crazy the Big 12 has been this year.
One of two at the line for Ahmad. And it looks like an over-the-back foul called on Maciej Bender.
The young Polish rifle freshman out of Poland getting an early look here by Bob Huggins. He was not happy with the effort on Saturday. And they've got to get back to playing the reckless defensive style that made them so effective the first two-thirds of the year.
Blocked at the rim was Odoms by Konate. Zach Konate doesn't play many minutes, but he's still eighth in the Big 12 in blocked shots at a little less than 1.5 per game. So an impact player covering the rim off the bench.
Trying to go inside. You see they've got that big lineup in there.
Shot clock down to 5. Carter lost it. Taken away by Jordan Woodard. And then Woodard tried to cross over, and it was right off the foot of Tariq Phillip. Now it's Doolittle. Fouled on the floor, says John Higgins. That foul called on Bender, already with 2, and Lon Kruger, 6th year here in Norman. And you talked about it on SportsCenter earlier. He basically has a lifetime contract. He has a young team. They're having one of the worst years that he's had as a head coach. But obviously, he has carte blanche here to do what he needs to do to try and rebuild this program, correct?
Well, absolutely, Bob. When you look at some of the heartbreaking losses this year, they've had 5 or 6 games slip through their hands. And this team is going to be very, very good. It reminds me an awful lot of those Buddy Hield, Isaiah Cousins teams when they were freshmen and sophomores.
Phillip for 3. Offensive rebound, Konate. But travel. Well, Thursday, an incredible ACC Pac-12 doubleheader on ESPN at 8 Eastern. Boy, nothing says rivalry week like the first matchup this year between Carolina and Duke in Durham. And then Oregon heads to Westwood to take on UCLA. So we'll get a primetime look at Lonzo Ball. Both games are Sonic Blockbusters, streaming live on the ESPN app and watch ESPN. How about Oregon? 9-1 in their last 10 against the top 25.
And they've won 19 out of 20, Bob. They're the quietest number 5 team in the country. They were picked in the top 5 or 6. They played early without Brooks and Dylan Brooks back now, and they are on fire. Tough game for them in Pauley.
McGusty wildly at Adrian. Flips one up. That won't go. And Jamoney McNeese's tip couldn't find the bottom as well. West Virginia hasn't made a shot in the last 4.5 minutes. Just that close to breaking streak. Tavon Myers on the drive. Had it roll out. Held ball, and it will stay with the Mountaineers. Well, Bob Huggins, as we said earlier today at shoot-around, was impatient, to say the least, with his team. How about the early response from the message he tried to deliver earlier today in these first 6 minutes?
Well, so far, you know, not a great effort, particularly offensively, with only 3 points. But for this team, it is about effort and creating offense off the defense. Haven't been able to do that yet.
Bolden, he'll try a three. Got it.
That's what he does, Bob, an outstanding shooter. He missed last season with an ACL injury. Look at this.
And out of pressure, creates a bucket for Bolden.
The young man from Northern Kentucky, he's got to get a little bit stronger, but they really like him, and boy, can he shoot the basketball. And that's the kind of energy they're looking for out of that defense. One guy that's going to be fresh this season is Beto Bolden.
Although now he fouls Woodard.
He's only played about 7 minutes a game in 15 of West Virginia's games.
He missed all of last year with a torn ACL in September, so a three-time All-State player in Kentucky. Stays on the floor, having scored West Virginia's last 5 points.
See how they shade Odoms to the right hand because he's so good going left.
Issa Ahmad gets the block. Back the other way comes Myers. Gives it up to Bolden. That's 7 in a row for Bolden. And it's a 1-point game.
How about this guy? He's averaging about 3.8 points a game.
He just committed his second foul, though. It's an 8-0 West Virginia run as they've cut the Oklahoma lead down to 1. And Bolden will head to the bench as he's got a couple of fouls.
Let's watch Adrian at the point of the press now, Bob. He is very active. This West Virginia team at their best, they get about 50 deflections a game. Balls tipped, knocked out of bounds. They had less than 20 on Saturday, a season low. Good pressure by Carter.
Pretty good job by Doolittle against a smaller player to get it across the timeline. Now he needs a timeout as the pressure from Javon Carter forced the timeout. So we'll step aside for 30 seconds and come right back to Norman. OU with a 1-point lead. Well, Bob Huggins wanted to see some effort. He just saw it this past sequence as the West Virginia Mountaineers all of a sudden stepped up the pressure, got a couple of backcourt takeaways and just forced a timeout as Darion Strong-Moore comes on for the first time. And there is a backcourt violation, it looks like, as Christian Doolittle runs it down as the shot clock winds down as well. So West Virginia picking up the defensive energy, and Franet has changed the game.
Well, and the guy that's changed the game the last two possessions is Javon Carter, two-time All-Big 12 defensive team. And his ball pressure the last two possessions has increased the intensity level of this team.
Myers around Christian James, but right into Jamoney McNeese.
Now West in the game, the freshman coming off a career high. A little more energy from the Mountaineers.
James, step back. Instead, there is an offensive foul called as Christian James gets hit with the push-off. We'll step aside with Oklahoma on top by 1 here in Norman.
It'll be interesting how much they get out of Giles, Bolden, and Tatum up front on Thursday night.
And you have Luke Kennard as a dark horse candidate on your wooden watch list, correct?
National Player of the Year, absolutely. Dark horse for sure, and likely to be an All-American, first or second team, no doubt about it. Best player on Thursday night is going to be Lonzo Ball of UCLA in the second game.
Carter comes up short.
Yeah, and I like what Carter's doing now. He's back to being a little bit of a bulldog, causing some havoc.
Tough matchup again as Adrian is out on McGusty.
They're not letting Odoms get to that left hand. Scouting report, D.
Doolittle misses long, run down by Lamont West, who had 21 on Saturday in the loss against Oklahoma State.
Another redshirt freshman. I don't know where Myers was throwing it. Bob Huggins sitting on that stool right there said, get him out.
Myers ended up on the bench, but it looks like Elijah Macon got an earful from Bob Huggins as much as Myers did. I think, reading lips, it was, why did you stop? As if he threw it to the rim. Why would you keep on heading towards the basketball and a lane to the hoop? Woodard lost it. And Doolittle is fouled. Over 5.5 minutes since Oklahoma last scored, yet they still have a one-point lead.
Yeah, they have struggled to score, but fortunately, West Virginia hasn't exactly been on target offensively as well.
I mean, when you think about this West Virginia team, you look at the rest of the top 10 and even most of the top 20, they're pros. You can name the pros right off the top of your head. I know you certainly can out of the other teams in the top 10. Well, for the most part this season, West Virginia has been in the top 10. They've gone back and forth a bit because of some of the losses to non-ranked teams, but with wins over Kansas and Baylor, both at home, and they've been in the top 10. Who are their pros? Well, what guys does Bob Huggins have that are McDonald's All-Americans, top 15, top 20 recruits? Well, none.
No, they don't. And so the whole has to be greater than the sum of the parts, which has been a huge recipe for their success the last 3 years.
Tariq Phillip is fouled by McGusty.
But I look around college basketball, and you look at the top 10 teams, and you know what? That's why Villanova is so highly thought of, because they don't necessarily have a surefire pro. And if you look at Kansas right now, who's their surefire pro outside of Josh Jackson? You know, a lot of those teams in the top 10 are teams that are veteran teams. This team is a veteran team, Bob, but they don't have stars. They have 10 guys that play 10 minutes or more, and everybody's got to contribute.
Yeah, I would say not that other teams in the top 10 don't, top 20 don't. Certainly they do. But I think no team, and no coach more specifically in Bob Huggins, milks more out of his talent than he does as Adrian flips one up. And the loose ball ends up in a 50-50 scrum that's won by Doolittle, and he is able to throw it off of Adrian out of bounds, so it goes to OU.
Smart play by the freshman. Grew up right in the Oklahoma City area, Edmond. Of course, he played at the same high school that produced Jordan Woodard, won state championship. Take a look right here. Jordan Woodard won two, but Doolittle helped him win one. And really good hustle by the freshman. And Woodard is the guy, Bob, that really has to be the catalyst for this team. He has struggled the last three or four games.
Doolittle has a shot blocked.
Smart play by Adrian. He just stayed vertical, backed off, made Doolittle shoot over him. I think when you talk about glue guys and guys that mean more to the team than their stats, there aren't many guys in the country that are more valuable to their team from that standpoint than the senior from Morgantown, Nathan Adrian.
Shot clock to 5. Woodard with Adrian caught on a switch. Crosses him over, gives it up. Doolittle an offensive rebound. And then a foul called, it looks like, on Tariq Phillip.
Yeah, he was trying to horse Kadeem Latin out of the way. Latin held his ground.
And that is Phillips' second. Brandon Watkins back in the game, and Rivalry Week will continue on Saturday night on ESPN. Two good ones. First in the ACC, Florida State and Notre Dame. That's probably more a football rivalry than a basketball rivalry, but the basketball version with Florida State coming off of a dominant win just before we came on the air, and then Gonzaga, St. Mary's in the WCC in Moraga. Both games streaming live on the ESPN app and watch ESPN. And between now and the end of the regular season in the WCC, that might be the last chance that Gonzaga actually has to lose. Wouldn't you say, on the road against St. Mary's?
Yes. And if you're going to that game, bring deodorant, because it's a small gym. It's going to be very hot in there.
I thought you said you could bring earplugs.
No, bring the deodorant, because they will pack them into that small but comfy gymnasium on the campus of St. Mary's in Moraga.
That's non-air-conditioned gym.
First time that game day makes their appearance in Moraga.
Adrian lost it on the way up, so that wasn't a comment leading towards all the hot air that's produced during game day. It's always hot in there. That's just with Seth and Jay are there.
There will be hot air in there. Forget Seth and Jay.
A fadeaway. That's a brick from Matt Freeman, and here comes Myers. Tries to cross over McGusty and get some help. Freeman threw up a brick at one end and came back and tossed it out of bounds at the other.
Another one of those freshmen, Matt Freeman. He's been in and out of the lineup. He's a freshman from New Zealand and known for his outside shooting. And you see the block right there. And one of the reasons he chose Oklahoma was because a fellow countryman said how much he enjoyed the state of Oklahoma, that being a guy by the name of Steven Adams, who plays for the Oklahoma City Thunder. You know, the reason I hesitated on St. Mary's Gonzaga is because BYU still goes to Gonzaga. In the last two seasons, when nobody gave BYU a chance to win at McCarthy, came away with a W.
Yeah, I'm not giving them a chance this year. Well, I think this is it for Gonzaga. If they lose on Saturday, that'll be it. Issa Ahmad on the drive. Well, lost it, but I don't see them losing, at least in the regular season.
Yeah.
Anything can happen in the tournament, especially if they play St. Mary's again. Nice drive by Shepard.
I would say the way St. Mary's played against Texas Arlington this year, where they lost by 17 at home, I don't think St. Mary's is as good a team or at the level that Gonzaga is, whereas BYU's got at least one pro in Eric Mika, who marked few last week compared to Domantas Sabonis, and that was a close game.
Matt Freeman picks up the foul. Oklahoma has stretched their lead up to 6. Under 8 to go here in the first half.
Good. Big game, Bob. Back to you. What do we got here?
Well, speaking of looking good, you've got Adnan and Andy in the studio. From an aesthetic standpoint, that is a halftime show you're looking forward to.
Looking good, I would say so. How about this? Beto Bolden, young man who has not played much this year, the fifth guard, he is the leading scorer for West Virginia right now. 7 of the team's 10 points. He's only played 2 minutes because he picked up 2 quick fouls.
Adrian, that's off the mark. Kadeem Latin able to scoop up the rebound.
West Virginia 1-for-14 minus Bolden.
McGusty buries a 3.
We have seen, Bob, over the course of the last few weeks, some really good performances from Cam McGusty. We've also seen some freshman plays from him at the end of a couple games, but that's part of the learning process.
Second time Oklahoma's opened up a 9-point lead. Issa Ahmad. Out to Bolden. He stays red hot. Double figures for the first time this season here in the first half.
And that is his career high. James Bolden, we mentioned he missed all last season with a knee injury. Used to watch him last year, Bob, shooting on his own. Couldn't do much cutting and running after the surgery.
He was a 2,000-point scorer in high school. Here's McGusty. Battle for the loose ball. Latin with a good job to tap it back. And McGusty thought he had another chance, but traveled on the drive, according to John Higgins.
Well, watch Bolden now. He's got 4 of the 5 field goals tonight in the first half for West Virginia, and what a bonus. No Daxter Miles, who's back home nursing an ankle sprain. And Bolden, who's been the fifth guard for this team, getting an opportunity and taking advantage of it.
He's got the last 10 points for the Mountaineers. They didn't score that whole time he was on the bench. Heat check.
Look at this.
Oh, my goodness.
Oh,
James Bolden with 13 points, his career high, all here in the first half. And he pulls West Virginia back within three.
You know, we talk about the young players in this league and how good they're going to be going forward. You know, Lamont West, a freshman for Bob Huggins at 21 on Saturday, Bolden tonight. And, you know, even on a night like this, Bob, you know, you got a team that's at the bottom of the league, West Virginia trying to get it going again. Always fun to see the newcomers really step up, see who the next Perry Ellis or Buddy Hield or George Niang is going to be.
Beetle Bolden has played less than 3 minutes, 2 minutes and 47 seconds to be exact, and he's got 13 points in less than 3 minutes. Adrian will go to the lock.
We might have to start calling him Microwave. Put those pepperoni rolls in the microwave.
He's got a little Vinnie Johnson to his game right now. Instant offense off the bench.
Will you promise me next time we're in Morgantown we go get some pepperoni rolls?
I'm not sure by looking at me it would come to you as a galloping shock that, yes, I would be in on a trip for pepperoni rolls.
Okay. Pepperoni rolls, by the way, someone told me invented. They were for the coal miners because of the way the cheese and the mozzarella and the dough stayed together. They put them in the foil, take them down into the mines, and pretty good lunch delicacy. Good hands. That's what we call those deflections and steals.
Bolden, no way.
No way. All right.
And we were right. Sooner or later, he had to miss. Here's Jordan Shepherd the other way. Off to Woodard. Through traffic. Lost it. A lot of contact. And I'm not sure a foul was called. A foul was not called against West Virginia, so they'll call it out of bounds off the Mountaineers. It'll stay with OU.
Jordan Woodard, one of the things he's done so well throughout his career, and he just tripped right there.
He did, just lost his balance.
Yep, is get himself to the foul line, and it's something he has not done particularly well lately.
Another backcourt violation. That is 8 turnovers here in the first half. Check that 9th turnover for Oklahoma.
And that's what I would call a turnover that wasn't forced necessarily by the defense.
Christian James had his pocket picked, though, by Issa Ahmad.
He's got big hands, and he came from behind and tipped it away. He's got the biggest hands, Bob, in the Big 12. Little more activity from that West Virginia defense in this first half, especially lately.
Carter off to Adrian for three. Nathan Adrian is shooting 46% from three in Big 12 games, far above the 33% he shoots for the season. The first lead for West Virginia.
There's that pressure on the ball.
James knocks down a triple of his own.
Oh, that's so big for Christian James. He was 4-for-27 behind the arc prior to that shot. He was a guy, Bob, that a lot of people expected to step right in where Buddy Hield left off.
Back-to-back misses now for James Bolden. Doolittle, the trailer. That's an ugly one that misses everything.
Almost traveled. Ron Cougar thought he did.
Carter for three. That's an air ball. So a couple of ugly trips, and what has been a low-scoring first half with Oklahoma on top of West Virginia.
Priscilla will agree.
I think Fran certainly will agree. And we are here in Norman, and we have heavy hearts of our own and condolences to send to Tony Caridi. He is the play-by-play voice of West Virginia, and he is working tonight here in Norman, his team on the road, despite the fact that he lost his mom last night after a battle with leukemia. So we wanted to send all of our good thoughts and prayers not only to Tony, but also to his entire family, as his mom passed away last night.
Yep, 92, married 59 years, and had a good talk with Tony before the game, and he came in today. And, of course, every time we come to Morgantown and get to the arena, he's a guy that we love talking to, part of that West Virginia sports family.
Tariq Phillip has got the loose ball with about 3.5 to go in the first half.
Man, West Virginia, Bob, they're averaging 87 points a game. And right now, they've just been in an offensive funk today. I think the energy level on the defensive end has been pretty good.
Shot clock winding down. Konate threw a double team. He turned it over. That's 7 West Virginia turnovers. This is a team that is number 2 in America in scoring margin, number 2 in the Big 12 in points per game, number 1, obviously, in turnovers forced and points off turnovers, adding up all of those great national rankings. And they're down by 2 on the road to an Oklahoma team that's 8-14 and that they lost 2 at home.
One of the things that happens sometimes with this style of play, and we've seen this the last couple of years, you do get used to playing against it, especially in the league where you see them twice. And the level of play in the Big 12 is certainly better overall than the level that they see in November and December.
Elijah Macon picks up his 2nd, and that's 18 fouls on the Mountaineers. So it's a 1-1 for Kadeem Latin. Brandon Watkins will send Macon to the bench.
You know, Bob, one of the things we say about pressure basketball is that it has a cumulative effect on the opponent. In other words, if you're playing 10 guys and you play more than the other team, you would hope by the middle of the second half you can wear them down. And when I watch West Virginia the last few games, I almost think they look like they've worn themselves down over the course of the first 2/3 of the season. The energy level's a little better tonight defensively, but it's still not at the high level it's been for much of the year.
Nice off the glass for Brandon Watkins.
Yeah, that was really good basketball. We call that a triangle. They put the 3 big guys inside, and Adrian is the playmaker at the foul line. Really nice.
How come the Knicks can't do that?
Yeah.
Another turnover. This time Doolittle lost the dribble. And Phillip, with some hustle, was able to bank it off his knees.
Watch when Adrian comes and gets the ball. You see the triangle inside right now? 3 bigs, 2 inside. And, of course, Adrian at the point of the triangle. Is that right? The base? No, not the base, right? The apex, or what, the point? Help me.
What?
Geometry. Give me trigonometry.
How were pepperoni rolls invented again? We should get back to that. Should get you off of the isosceles and back onto delicacies. Yeah. West straight away.
Big
hits
time.
A 3.
Yep. This kid's a big, big-time shooter. He redshirted last year. He was 17 years old. And this year, as an 18-year-old freshman, he's had moments of brilliance. And he's a junior and a senior, Bob. I predict he's going to be a Big 12 star.
Wide open Doolittle. The long rebound ends up with Adrian after West and Carter had a same team situation. Now a turnover, and Woodard cruises in for 2, ties the game.
Javon Carter doesn't give the ball up that easily. You know, if you look at his face, it reminds me of Frank Mason the other night. Just a fatigued look.
Well, Thursday, an incredible ACC Pac-12 doubleheader on ESPN. You want to talk about some Sonic blockbusters? We've got 2. The first meeting of the season and the highlight of rivalry week as North Carolina takes on Duke and Durham. And then it's Oregon taking on Lonzo Ball and UCLA in Westwood. Both games streaming live on the ESPN app and watch ESPN. And we've got not only the whittled down list of the top 20 for the Wooden Award, but you actually took your top five. Now, these are in no particular order, but two of those five players are going to be playing in our Sonic Blockbusters on Thursday night. We'll see Luke Kennard against Carolina, and Lonzo Ball has really transformed that UCLA program.
Yep, amazing. And Lonzo Ball is going to be a top two or three pick. And as a player, I haven't seen in recent years a guy that could, one player could transform an entire program. Remember, Steve Alford, they were calling, a lot of alumni were calling for his job during the offseason. And the job he's done, Lonzo Ball, TJ Leaf, Bryce Alford, that is a fun team to watch. Now they're back inside in that triangle.
Bolden.
Tough shot.
Short. Adrian with the hustle play, keeps it alive. Finds Bolden. He's shut down by Doolittle. Another scramble for the basketball, and it looks like it will be a pile up and a held ball, and it will end up with the Sooners.
Yeah, Bolden tried to draw contact inside, but there really wasn't anything there. And if you're his size, the defender needs to just stay vertical. Take a look. Watch the little dump off. And I think it's Doolittle. He just waits for Bolden to leave his feet, and he's got that size advantage.
Christian Doolittle was the number one player in Oklahoma on our recruiting boards at ESPN.com.
Well, he's had some monster games. We saw the 29 and 10 rebounds at Texas. Really outstanding. And then that double-double here against Iowa State in the double overtime loss.
Jordan Shepherd out to Woodard for three. Adrian was able to out-duel his own teammate Lamont West for the rebound. And now West Virginia can hold for the final shot of the first half.
And Bolden's going to have the ball at the end of the half. Let's see what he's got.
Around Lackey. Easy two. What an impact James Bolden made in the first half. He played about seven total minutes for West Virginia, and he's the leading scorer by far. He's got 15. A low-scoring first half. West Virginia has the lead, trying to get revenge against OU. Back to the studio, Andy and Adnan. Welcome back to Norman, just about set for the start of the second half. Oklahoma trailing West Virginia by two as the Mountaineers looking for some revenge, having lost in overtime in Morgantown to Oklahoma. The first meeting between these two teams last month. Bob Lashus and Fran Fraschilla, thanks for spending part of your Wednesday with us. Interesting story that you have to tell from a name that Bob Huggins brought up to his team at Shootaround today and how it might play into the role that James Bolden played for Bob Huggins' team in the first half.
Well, there's no Daxter Miles. He's home with an ankle sprain. And Bob Huggins said at the Shootaround today, does anybody know who Wally Pipp is? Well, Wally Pipp is the guy that got hurt. A guy named Lou Gehrig went into the Yankee starting lineup and then proceeded to play 2,130 straight games. Well, tonight, Beto Bolden in the first half, off the bench, career high, 15 points. I mean, think about it, Bob. He's got 15 of their 27. This guy didn't even score on Saturday. He's been the fifth guard most of the year.
Yeah, Bolden had not had more than 9 points in a game this season. He had 15 in the first half. No other West Virginia player had more than four. So, I mean, he's carrying them like Kobe Bryant used to carry the Lakers. We'll see if he can keep it going in the second half, but certainly when you play like that, you're going to earn yourself some more playing time. He was a microwave off the bench, and even with his effort, West Virginia only managed 34% shooting in the first half. That's the bad news for the Mountaineers. The good news, they've got the lead because they held OU to 30%.
And they forced 11 turnovers, which is more to Bob Huggins' liking. And there's that inside triangle we talked about, been very effective tonight. That means they can play the three big guys inside.
Carter, a little too strong. Offensive rebound. The putback won't go for Minkin. And eventually, Kadeem Latin is fouled.
Boy, and I'm surprised Macon didn't use a backboard on that last offensive rebound. Point blank, he knows it. Now West Virginia bringing that pressure.
They call the foul on Nathan Adrian, his first. It's a five count. A 5 second violation as Oklahoma couldn't get it in. So there is Press Virginia forcing a turnover before Oklahoma can even get the ball on the court.
And by this time of year, I don't care if you're playing young players, you ought to be able to know how to get the ball inside against that pressure.
Ahmad turns it over. Jordan Woodard the other way. Gets it up to McGusty. Floats one up towards the rim as he was going down to the deck, and he's slow to get up. Tariq Phillip at the other end can't score it. Kadeem Latin's got the rebound.
Well, right now we have two gangs that can't shoot straight. Opportunities to score in close. Neither team can come up with anything.
Woodard, old school floater over Adrian, rolls off the rim. Boy, there is a lid on the basket at both ends. For everyone except James Bolden. See how long it takes Bob Huggins to put him back in the game.
See, Oklahoma doing a lot of switching. West Virginia, five-man motion. Oklahoma's basically zoning it up.
Phillip, played through contact. Good defense by Oklahoma. No foul called. And here's McGusty.
Oh, Latin inside.
They get it to him, and he'll go to the free throw line. Second on Adrian. So Kadeem Latin, who one day says he's like to be the mayor of Houston, where he grew up. He is one of two players that has been selected to the NCAA's Men's Basketball Oversight Committee. So he is a really unique individual.
That's right. And the other one is my buddy Nick Norton down at UAB, who's out this season with ACL surgery. He's coming back strong. He'll be a big part of the Blazers going forward.
What does that mean to you when you hear about one of two players selected to the oversight committee?
Well, if you know Kadeem, he's a kid with multifaceted interests, and it's not just basketball. This young man spent a year in Spain playing basketball at essentially a basketball academy, and then came back, finished in Houston.
And now he gets the block. Out of bounds to Oklahoma.
Well, he's fourth all time on Oklahoma's block list. He's about 50 blocks away from number three, and that would happen to be a guy by the name of Wayman Tisdale. But there you see Kadeem Latin. Came into tonight with 154 career blocks. I'll tell you, one of his best performances, Bob, was last year in Morgantown. Devin Williams, their outstanding center for the Mountaineers, could not score in the painted area.
Hand check foul called on Javon Carter.
You know, I know it's early, mid-February, but it's like two teams who have been playing in quicksand tonight. It's like they each practiced for 3 hours today and now are out here playing in a game.
Scramble for the ball on the deck. Adrian makes the hustle play. It's out of bounds and it belongs to West Virginia.
Well, once again, Nathan Adrian, who's already got a pretty good floor burn from hustle in the first half. Take a look now. They're just going to lay out. Nathan Adrian doing what Nathan Adrian has done all season. Now, where did
Bad
that
play
come
by
from?
Issa Ahmad.
Unbelievable.
Trying to bank one out of bounds. Just turns it over, throwing it to nowhere. But then Jordan Woodard with an ugly drive. At the opposite end, here's Adrian. He can't lay it in. Back the other way, but losing the basketball, Rashard Odoms. And so far, this entire game has not been a highlight film that either group's going to want to watch later.
This might be, Bob, the worst 3 minutes of basketball in the Big 12 this season. Both teams.
So far, we are scoreless here in the second half. 27-25, West Virginia was our halftime score.
Where is Beadle?
And what's taking Bob Huggins so long? Reach-in foul called on Jordan Shepherd. He got Javon Carter across the wrist. That's his second.
We know how good West Virginia has played, and we know that Oklahoma, while they've struggled, has some talent. But first 3 minutes of the second half, the execution has not been what we're accustomed to. Remember that John McKay story when he coached the Tampa Bay Buccaneers? A reporter asked him about the team's execution, and he said, "I'm in favor of it."
Tariq Phillip finally scores. That's the first points of the second half for either team. And now a timeout has to be called by McGusty because he couldn't find a way to get the ball inbound. Well, West Virginia, they sometimes are at their best when they make the game look ugly, and they've got the four-point lead. It was a pretty day outside the Lloyd Noble Center here in Norman, but not pretty inside so far tonight. We've got 19 total combined field goals between OU and West Virginia and 25 combined turnovers. West Virginia's got the four-point lead, and they just about created the 16th Oklahoma turnover. Instead, it's McGusty floating one up. Is able to throw it down. That might be the prettiest play of the night for either team.
And that ball got slightly tipped by Issa Ahmad, but not enough to change the trajectory. And Latin on both ends now having a little bit of an effect. Bob, one thing we haven't talked about was West Virginia's trip into Norman. These guys were 7 hours late. They got to bed at 2 o'clock in the morning. They were stuck in Clarksburg waiting for three different planes before they finally got off the ground.
Doolittle, he'll shoot when we come back. Yeah, West Virginia looks a little sluggish. At least they have an excuse that you talked about. But Kadeem Latin just with a highlight play a moment ago as Oklahoma turned defense into offense and Latin finished at the other end. We just showed you a Kadeem Latin alley-oop as we went to break. That's not Latin's only highlight against West Virginia. The tip-in with under 10 seconds to play last year when it was number 11 West Virginia against number 2 Oklahoma. And after that win, OU moved to number 1 for the first time since March of 1990. Buddy Hield was giving Kadeem Latin a big hug. Hield had 17 in that win as well, 70-68 on the Latin tip-in to give OU an emotional home win here at Lloyd Noble last year against the Mountaineers. Then they followed that up with a win in Morgantown as a big road underdog back in mid-January. And now they're in a tussle with number 13 at home here on February 8th.
Three freshmen out there for Lon Kruger right now. Been that way for much of the season. 8 freshmen and sophomores getting a lot of playing time.
Tough catch, but yep. A nice finish by Elijah Macon.
That time Macon used a glass. Went to school on that earlier miss.
The West Virginia starters have only combined for 13 total points so far. Nice drive, coast to coast. The sophomore Rashard Odoms.
What do we say about the strong hand, Bob? Left. And that time he caught it on the left side of the floor. He goes about 70 miles an hour with the left hand, about 45 with the right hand. And you saw what he can do when he gets in the open court.
Foul away from the ball called on Lamont West.
Take a look now. This is where he's at his best, Rashard Odoms. This is a guy that played very little in Big 12 play as a freshman on that veteran team, but he has been a really really improved player as a sophomore this year.
Well, Jordan Woodard's a senior, but you can certainly make the argument that the three next best players, as Jordan Shepherd, who is a freshman, throws one away. Cameron McGusty, Rashard Odoms, Christian Doolittle for this OU team. Two freshmen and a sophomore. So
yes,
the youth movement is there for Lon Kruger. Can he meld them as a team and ultimately get them to be a winner?
Oh, I don't think there's any question. It may not happen this year, but think about how close they've been on so many occasions. You know, you look at what Texas did last night at home, knocking off Iowa State. These two teams, Texas and Oklahoma, bottom of the league, but two of the youngest teams in the country.
Carter for three. He knocks down a triple. Big shot for West Virginia. And that helps them extend their lead. This is their largest up to five, and they get the press set up.
And part of this press is randomly trapping, leaving your man coming to double. And there you see the double right there. Good flash by Doolittle.
Does serve a purpose, though, because the shot clock already under 10. By the time you finally get comfortable and get your half court set, it's like an NBA shot clock down to three. Shepherd has to try a three, and he hits with one on the timer.
How about this, Bob? He had six total points in Big 12 play, and he knocks down three right there. That's a young man that originally signed at Appalachian, at James Madison, excuse me. A coaching change, so Oklahoma grabbed him in the springtime.
Backcourt foul on Javon Carter, harassing Jordan Shepherd, who just hit this big three.
Yeah, he's been up and down, but got a couple starts early in the year, 17 or 18 against Memphis. And you see Carter playing off, and Carter's got to know, low shot clock, get into him, make him drive it. Don't give him the point-blank look behind the arc, and that's what he did.
That foul on Carter, his second. Jamani McNeese replaces Kadeem Latin. Odoms on the bench as well as Dante Buford has come on for OU.
Right now, this is an entire Oklahoma team of freshmen and sophomores.
James allows the flyby, steps inside for two. Tariq Phillip stripped away. It will stay with West Virginia. Surprised it took this long to get James Bolden in the game as Phillip goes to the bench. 15 points in the first half for Bolden. And it takes Bob Huggins about 7.5 minutes of playing time in the second half to get his offensive weapon back in.
He doesn't want to waste them, Bob. Come on, you know?
Is that the strategy?
Only got too many bullets in the gun. Was it 15 and 7 minutes, you said, right? He's got to pick his spots. Last couple shots he took were contested. And don't forget, Devon Myers can heat up, too. He once led the country in scoring in junior college.
Bolden, a little too strong. The tip follow wouldn't go, but Bolden ends up with the loose ball. That shot blocked, but a foul call. The little late whistle.
Guess who's going to shoot, too?
But Chance Moore, the official on the far side, puts James Bolden at the line as he will look to build on a career night.
Let me tell you something. Right now for West Virginia, Bob Huggins has four freshmen on the floor in Bender and Kanade, Bolden, and West.
Tonight after Bulls Warriors on ESPN at SportsCenter at night with Stan and Neil. They'll have the NBA, NHL, and college basketball night, plus everything else from your Wednesday in sports. SportsCenter at night over on ESPN after the NBA, streaming live on the ESPN app, and watch ESPN.
Vito Bolden's about 2 points a minute right now, Bob. A little over that.
I felt old the other day. I forget who we were talking to at one of the shoot-arounds, but you mentioned the name Vidi Johnson, and the player you were talking to was McGusty. Gets shut down. Had no idea who Vidi Johnson was. Bolden, how did he not walk with the basketball? Still ended up turning it over. Oklahoma will have it down by four when we come back.
Well, we talked about freshman, Bob. It's been Bolden. But how about Kanade? Watch him wall up at the rim right here. Not coming into my house. Sag Kanade. Remember the name?
We got momentum with big game, Bob.
Hey, by the way, Bob, Cincinnati's got to go to SMU on Sunday. Battle for the top of the American. Two outstanding teams.
Well, Zadnan and Andy were just talking about, Missouri hasn't won on the road since 2014. Shot clock down to six. James gives it up. Woodard with three on the timer. Off the mark from three. It's out of bounds, and it will go to West Virginia.
Well, I said it earlier, Bob, as Jordan Woodard goes, so does Oklahoma. And in the last four games, he has certainly not been the Jordan Woodard we're accustomed to seeing over the last four seasons.
He came into tonight 8 of 37 from the field over his last four, including 5 of 16 from three. And this is a player that's closing in on 1,500 career points at Oklahoma, but this is a tough senior season. To have all that success with the Spanglers and Heels and Cousins of the World and, you know, your Final Four team, and then to be the lone remaining veteran player on this team with all these young guys learning how to win. It's been quite a roller coaster for Jordan Woodard, and the crowd again not happy with the call that keeps it with the Mountaineers.
Well, speaking of point guards, there's a young man from Norman, Oklahoma. He's going to make a decision here in the next couple of weeks. He's going to choose between Kansas and Oklahoma. Trey Young, one of the top 10 players in the country. McDonald's All-American selection. He's got the great tradition of Kansas to pick from. And, of course, the opportunity to play right here close to home.
Dante Buford called for a foul, and on the inbounds, Adrian lays it up and in.
This game has been sort of a microcosm of the Oklahoma season. Close, and then some mistakes, sloppy play.
Held ball. Pressure from Tavon Myers. It'll stay with Oklahoma, but Christian James thought he had drawn a foul.
That's the kind of energy Bob Huggins wants to see. Tavon Myers and Bolden off the bench. Myers got all ball. But the arrow pointed in Oklahoma's direction. Did you see Bolden almost sneak from behind?
He was looking for a door to the basket. McGusty gets his own miss and dribbles it out of trouble. Shot clock violation. His shot didn't hit the rim, so the timer wound all the way down. It's another Oklahoma turnover.
How about the big fella, Sags Kanate, once again challenging everything at the rim.
And 18 forced turnovers now by West Virginia. That's back to normal basketball for the Mountaineers.
Really good energy. You see the mismatch. McGusty thought he could get all the way to the rim, and then the young freshman from Mali won a Pennsylvania State Championship last year at Kennedy Catholic and Sharon, PA.
Issa Ahmad connects. It's the largest lead for number 13, West Virginia, up to 8.
Part of it, Bob, is I really think the energy of Bolden and Myers in the backcourt, the harassment. This looks more like a West Virginia team we've seen when they've been at their best.
Woodard. Out of bounds. 18 to shoot for Oklahoma.
And we talk about all the young teams in this league, and this West Virginia team has got some really impressive young players, particularly that freshman class. They're going to be around three more years.
Thursday, we've got that big doubleheader highlighting rivalry week. The ACC leads off with the first meeting this season at 8 Eastern between Carolina and Duke. And then we head to the Pac-12 for the second half of our doubleheader, Oregon, UCLA. Both games, Sonic Blockbusters, and streaming live on the ESPN app. And watch ESPN. And how vital is this game for both North Carolina and Duke? We take a look at the standings, and there is Carolina. They are right now at the top of the ACC. Duke, middle of the pack, but Syracuse has really come on of late. They've got a big one with Louisville on Monday night, a game that you will be at. They've got a challenge as well before that on Saturday against Pitt.
That's right. They've won five in a row when things look bleak up in Syracuse, and all of a sudden, wheels starting to turn for that team. Andrew White, the transfer, been really good. Tyler Lydon playing really well. And how about John Gillen, the transfer from Colorado State? He dropped 43 against NC State last week in that great comeback win. I'll tell you, it's a big game for North Carolina, Bob, because they realistically have a chance at a number one seed. They got a really difficult February road that starts Thursday.
Doolittle over Adrian. Knocks it down.
Adrian did about everything he could. He's smiling because I think he thinks Doolittle shot that ball and didn't even look at the rim.
Both teams, by the way, after that last timeout, a little slow to come out of their respective huddles. And so both have been issued a bench warning by the officials. Benate, a handoff to Ahmad with eight to shoot. Issa Ahmad, Adrian from the wing. Yes!
A great delivery by Ahmad. They didn't have anything inside, so Adrian floated out to the corner. And once again, Bob, you know, we highlighted Adrian at the top of the show. Forget the points, just to all the little things he does for this team on the court.
Ordered foul by Bolden. It'll be a 1-1. Team foul number 7 on West Virginia. And the third on Bolden.
Ahmad drives into the lane, and watch Adrian, deep corner. Big time.
So Woodard at the line, 85% free throw shooter, and he needs these. He only has 4 points tonight. Again, when Oklahoma went to West Virginia back in mid-January and pulled off the 89-87 overtime upset, Jordan Woodard had 20, and it felt like he had 40. He dominated the second half in overtime of that game, but tonight looks a little bit more like the player we've seen over the past several weeks, where he's back to really struggling, a roller coaster, and only with 6 so far tonight.
Yep, it's been a really up roller coaster is the best way to describe his season. There's no doubt about that. And you see, they try to work it inside. There's that triangle again. Good job. And again, Adrian at the top of that triangle. He's the point guard from the foul line in. And when you got Kanate and Ahmad and Adrian, you got 3 wide bodies that right now trying to pound it inside.
Well, when Jamani McNeese realized that Issa Ahmad had Jordan Shepherd at only 6'2" pinned under the basket, came flying over to do the best he could to help, and one shot fake got him in the air. Forced the foul that puts him out at the free throw line.
I'll tell you what, Tariq Phillip and Javon Carter got a nice rest, didn't they? Good job by Myers and Bolden. That's the kind of depth we talked about in the backcourt. There's that pressure again.
West Virginia builds an 8-point lead, but there are 2 lead guards on the bench.
See if they randomly come trap.
Timeout call. I think Woodard thought he was fouled, was caught up against the sideline, and before he lost his balance out of bounds, Oklahoma able to use a timeout, but his game starting to get away from this. A lot of times playing a little later at night when the East Coast maybe has gone to bed. That's a game worth staying up for.
Oh, yeah.
If you're in the East on Thursday night, right? Checking those 2 teams out on what those 2 might be as factors in March Madness.
Without a doubt. Remember, Oregon came in, right, as a top-5 team. We saw them at Baylor without Dylan Brooks. Then they struggled in Maui. Bob, they've won 19 out of 20. Brooks is back, relatively healthy. Depth in the backcourt, size inside. And they played a great first game with UCLA and Eugene, so that gave it Paulie It's going to have all the makings of an Elite Eight Final Four type game.
Nice pass from Shepherd to Doolittle, but net at the rim by Kanata.
Hey, that is three impressive plays in the second half by the freshman. Family of basketball players, older brother plays up at Minnesota for Richard Pitino, Bakari.
Now Kanata lost it underneath, but a foul call. Reach-in called on Jordan Shepherd. That's his third.
I told you early in the year, Bob, this kid, Kanate, reminds me of Al Horford in terms of the size and the build. He's certainly not the player yet, but you talk about timing. This young man's got great timing and only a freshman.
From Mali, came to the U.S. just before his junior year of high school.
He's got a lot of his family here now. Family, a lot of boys, couple playing college basketball. Excellent students.
Issa Ahmad bowls his way to the goal. Rebound and a put back by Nathan Adrian. Largest lead for West Virginia.
Well, not to state the obvious, but if you watch West Virginia all season long, there's not a more important player, in my opinion, on this West Virginia team than Nathan Adrian.
Now an offensive foul call.
You know, if you think about it, Bob, they've got five guards that can all play. They've got some big guys. Page did a really good job of stepping in. They've got guys that if you lose a Daxter Miles or a Issa Ahmad on a given night, you can replace them with a Brandon Watkins or a Macon. I'm not sure you can replace what Nathan Adrian means to this team.
That foul on Odoms, his first. Well, Adrian's number three in the Big 12 in offensive rebounds per game, number five in the league, shooting the three during conference play. How often do you see that combination?
Yeah.
One of the top three-point shooters and offensive rebounders all at the same time. And there's Javon Carter with a triple from the corner, and West Virginia extends to a 13-point lead.
Hey, how many times do you see a guy like Adrian that has more offensive rebounds than he does defensive rebounds in the course of an entire season? That's unheard of.
Odoms can't throw it down. Kadeem Latin sets up Doolittle.
How about Kanate? He's waving that finger like Dikembe.
Shepherd, that floater won't go. Kadeem Latin runs it down. Oklahoma not lacking for hustle, keeping it alive and extending the possession. They just can't score. Woodard turns the corner. Now he's double-teamed. Throws it away. Nope, check that, saved. Knock it down at three is Shepherd. And what does John Higgins have? It looks like he's got a foul called on Kanate with the shot in the air.
And that's going to give Oklahoma a couple free throws as well and maybe make this a five-point play.
Wow, that's a big call.
Kanate, who's been as active as anybody on the court tonight, he tells John Higgins, you're right, I'm sorry, I pushed him. Shot goes up and he just shoves Latin in the back. And Latin, the upperclassman, that reminded me of Landon Lucas right there. Latin fell down like he got hit by a Mack truck. My man Landon Lucas is the best. Kansas. He's like a 12-year NBA veteran that knows all the tricks, you know?
Two at the line for Latin, and it's a five-point trip for Oklahoma. That gets the crowd back in the game and, to a certain extent, gets them back in the game down by eight.
I had to get that in because I love the way Landon Lucas plays. Defensively, he was unbelievable the other night in Manhattan. Here's that little three-man inside game we've been talking about.
Ahmad with a size advantage on McGusty. Goes around him, but then a size advantage for Kadeem Latin, who got the block.
I'll tell you what, they have opened the door, West Virginia, to a little comeback now by the Sooners.
Latin in the post. Over McGusty, over Kanate. Connects.
Here we go. That five-point play has opened the door.
Phillip hit the underside of the rim. Latin's got it. Here's McGusty.
I push it. They are.
Woodard has it taken away by Phillip, and a foul called on Latin. Tariq Phillip felt the elbow upside the head of Kadeem Latin, I think he wants more than just a common foul call.
I think they should check this. I think they need to go to the monitor on this. I don't think they will. And I don't think Latin necessarily did it on purpose, but you'll see right there the arm. I would go take a look at it, but they're not going to.
It was actually the first contact, I think, that shook up Phillip more than the wraparound.
Well, first of all, Jordan Woodard cannot.
Right here.
Yeah.
Ouch. That's where he got hurt.
Now, I think when they look at this, they've got to review it, Bob, because it was contact above the shoulders.
Having seen a couple of replays ourselves, though, does that strike you as anything more than Kadeem Latin just
no,
going after the basketball?
No, to me, it's got to be excessive, and I don't think that was necessarily any more than a regular.
Yeah, I think John Higgins saw one replay, the same that we did, and said, no, that's just a common foul. I mean, he sees the basketball. He's reaching for it.
Yes.
His elbow makes contact with the cheek of Phillip. That's incidental contact.
You have to review it because of the contact above the shoulders, but that's about as quick as a review as you need on that.
Well, both teams over the limit with 8 fouls apiece. Tariq Phillip has been in double figures in 6 of his last 8 games, but he's only got 3 so far tonight. Augusti gets it into Doolittle, who's double teamed, taken away. Tariq Phillips got it, and there is Press Virginia at their best.
Absolutely, and if you're a Mountaineer fan, you're saying that's more like it. That's the kind of effort we've needed. We've seen a lot of that tonight. Maybe not the full 40, but certainly more.
Bad pass by Phillip, though, throwing it to nowhere. And Bob Huggins with outstretched arms, I think wondering what the heck a senior guard was thinking. Woodard for 3. Long rebound to McGusty. Shepherd pulls up. That's no good. Offensive rebound, Latin. McGusty. Thought about it again. Now he'll drive it. Hangs and hits. McGusty, double figures for the 11th game in a row.
Terrific job of handling the contact and staying with it. Nice little double pump.
McGusty's got 11, but he hadn't scored in 22 minutes before that bucket. Now Bob Huggins wants a timeout. He's still all over Tariq Phillip for the pass prior to that Oklahoma possession.
Cam McGusty, Bob. We've seen this all season. There you go. Hang in the air.
Bob Lachuz and Fran Fraschilla back with a look at our Bracket Buzz brought to you by Cheez-It. Here's Joey Brackets, Joe Lenardi, and where he has the Big 12 teams projected if the tournament were to start tomorrow. 2-1 seeds right now with Kansas and Baylor. And by the way, Baylor's already won tonight over Oklahoma State and Stillwater by 3, 72-69. West Virginia right now as a 3 seed. And 7 out of the 10 teams in the league, according to Joe Lenardi, would be tournament teams. Well, as things stand right now.
How about Texas Tech? They're 18-8. In the next 4 games, they have Kansas, Baylor, West Virginia, and Iowa State coming up.
Yikes.
A couple of those at home, bud. So,
clock to 3. Carter with the shot clock at 1. Did he get it off? Doesn't matter. Didn't hit the rim anyway. Shot clock violation. And the sideline for West Virginia, not so much Bob Huggins, but his assistant coaches all over the players on the floor for having no recognition of the fact that the shot clock was winding down.
Yeah, no court awareness. I'll tell you, Myers and Bolden gave this team a huge lift tonight. They would not be up in this game if it weren't for those two youngsters off the bench. Phillip and Carter, by their standards, have been below average, in my opinion.
Another takeaway off pressure, though. 22 turnovers forced now by West Virginia.
I think they're going to run some clock, run some 5-man motion here. See if they can get a mismatch. Oklahoma loves to switch out front.
Phillip for 3. Offensive rebound, Kanate.
How good has he been tonight, Bob? The block shots, the energy on the glass. A lot of confidence in that freshman late in the game by Bob Huggins. Low clock again.
Down to five. Ahmad from the corner. Yes, with two on the shot clock. And now I believe that's 27 points off turnovers scored by West Virginia tonight. 22 turnovers forced, 27 points off those turnovers. That is the West Virginia formula.
I agree. And how about Ahmad, who did not score on Saturday?
Shepard is fouled.
Yep, that's one of those plays where Adrian was claiming verticality, but I think he jumped into the driver. He's going to argue his case to no avail. Jordan Shepard's been pretty solid tonight.
Third on Nathan Adrian. Outstanding execution of the announcer jinx by Fran Fraschilla. And OU cannot afford to leave any points at the free throw line now. They struggled to score all night with a chance to get some freebies. Now down 56-48. West Virginia fouls you and gives you an opportunity at the line. You have to knock them down.
West Virginia is going to spread the floor. I think they're going to use as much of this shot clock as they can.
Ahmad drives it and once again will go to the line.
Well, I like that because West Virginia just free switches out front, and when Ahmad saw Jordan Woodard on him at 6 feet tall, he said, I can take this guy to the basket. Good recognition of the defensive coverage.
This is the final 1-1 for either team. Both teams now have 9 fouls. And Oklahoma also out of timeouts. According to our BPI, Oklahoma has played the toughest schedule in America. This is the 5th ranked opponent that they've played tonight. And among all of those tough games, they've got 3 overtime losses and 5 other losses by 4 points or less. Doolittle. No. Donate rips it away. Foul called, I think, on Kadeem Latin.
I'll tell you what, Bob. He only has 4 rebounds, but he's got 5 blocks tonight. Kanate has been a huge, huge difference at the defensive rim. He's basically put a lid on that basket. Hasn't scored, but he has affected the game in a major way. And how about this, Bob? If this game, the way we're going right now, the leading scorer tonight for West Virginia is going to be a young man who played 10 minutes tonight. Beetle Bolden, who's right now. Get out of the way, Coach Harrison.
There he is.
There he is. Young man from Northern Kentucky who we told you missed all last season with a knee injury. 17 points in 10 minutes. Wally Pipp. I got to explain that again. Probably do, right?
And then maybe explain Vinnie Johnson.
Yeah.
After you explain Wally Pipp.
Good no call right there. Don't need to score. Good decision right there by the veteran. Phillip realizes time is better than the 4 shot.
And now Carter will go to the line as Jordan Woodard, who thought that he had worked his way into 3 free throws on the shot fake on Carter, didn't get the call. And a frustrating night, a frustrating season for the senior continues as his foul puts Carter at the line.
And he's going to talk himself into a technical foul if this keeps up. John Higgins is standing right next to Jordan Woodard. It's been a frustrating year. He missed some games because of a medical issue.
When you're part of a team that goes nearly as far as a team can go, you're a Final Four squad last year, and then your senior season isn't even going to end up with a bid to the NIT, that's hard. That's not the way that Jordan Woodard's career is supposed to end at Oklahoma.
That's right, because he has had a tremendous career already.
And we could talk all we want about the bright future of the Sooners and how they've got some freshmen this year, including Jordan Shepherd, that have shown promise. That doesn't do much for Jordan Woodard, though.
Nope.
A bounce back, though, for West Virginia tonight, Fran, as they lost at home in a game where Bob Huggins questioned their effort against Oklahoma State. He challenged their effort today at shoot-around, and they responded with forcing 22 turnovers and scoring 27 points off those turnovers tonight.
Well, they need to, because they're going to play Kansas State Saturday, and they're going to go to KU on Monday. And they've got, like everybody in the Big 12, got to run the gauntlet at some point.
And Woodard will dribble out the clock, and West Virginia gets a road win and some revenge against Oklahoma after the Sooners got a win in Morgantown last month. So a bounce back for West Virginia. They've got Kansas State on Saturday before the big Monday trip to Kansas on Monday night. West Virginia wins it by 11. Kevin Connors, Nicole Briscoe standing by with SportsCenter.